Hello and welcome to the Practice Parlour. Thank you to everyone who is watching here today. And I'm with my guest, Claire Galloway.
Hello.
Claire is a soprano. She performs in operas, concerts, recitals, oratorios, and she's also a teacher. She specializes in diction, particularly French diction, and also she just ran her course Core Foundations. And that's what we are here today to talk about, all about the core, getting to the core of it as both a singer, an artist, and also as a human. So welcome, Claire. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks so much for having me, Gina. I'm so excited about this.
Me too. So Claire, I would love just to begin with your story. How, not only how you got interested in singing, but how you got interested in the core and how that sort of became a specialty of yours.
Yeah, definitely. So I could go on to a very long story, but basically I always loved singing and music as a kid. I actually wanted to be a Broadway singer in high school, and my parents said, well, you should probably take some voice lessons and then we can see, maybe you can audition for college. And my voice teacher at the time gave me some classical technical foundation stuff. And she said, don't worry, you know, you should start with classical foundations and you can go anywhere. Think of like Audra McDonald. And I was like, cool, I'm in, let's go. And then I felt that my voice actually really was really at home and comfortable in classical music, whereas I was never the best belter. And from then on, I just kind of fell in love with classical music and learned more and more about it and realized that I could combine my love of languages with the music that I was working on. So I was just totally sold. And then in college, I had a voice teacher come in. It was a new voice teacher who joined the faculty about halfway through. And he was like a very physical teacher, which I'd never had before. I mean, he was having me like lean against his fist as I was breathing and things like that. And I'd never experienced how powerful my voice could be. I always thought of my voice as kind of smaller. And my teacher kept saying, no, you have a pretty large voice. And I was like, yeah, whatever, whatever you say. And then I went on this journey of having very physical teachers who really started to connect the breath with physicalization. And I started to realize that you don't need to feel vocally fatigued after you've practiced or sung. And the more that you're strong in your body and understand strength being tied with flexibility, the more longevity you have, the more flexibility you have. Because I always wanted to paint things very musically, but I would just get vocally fatigued because I was trying to control it with my throat muscles and my brain. And I was what I call a floating head singer, where you're just kind of stuck up here and not connected to your mechanism. So really understanding how to connect to the entirety of my body was an entire new world for me. I started to feel like I really had found my core unique sound, which allowed me to be the artist I'd always wanted to be.
I love that. And I love how you talked about combining the strength and the flexibility together, because mm-hmm. I find that so often we go to one extreme or the other, right? We engage our core, but we tighten up and then we have a lot of unnecessary tension.
Yeah.
Or we think relax and then we relax everything and there's no engagement.
Yeah. And I feel like often, you know, choral conductors and coaches and conductors and even teachers will just kind of yell out action verbs at you, like support. And so you're like, okay, I want to support. And it turns into this like Hulk smash, get your six pack abs and all this stuff. And it's just really restrictive. And then the same thing, it's an action verb. Actually, the verb relax is an action verb. And so you're like, okay, well, I'll just let everything go and nothing works anymore.
So I would love to get clear on some definitions. We throw these words around a lot as singers and as teachers. When we talk about the core, let's start with the physical core. What are we talking about?
Yeah. So a lot of times when people think about the core, they think about like Pilates, or they think about their core training program that's like wrapped up with Beachbody or one of the bigger fitness programs and things like that. And they're thinking mostly about their abs. They're thinking about like the getting a 12 pack or whatever it is. But the core is actually 360 degrees around your body. It's like a corset. So it's your abs, but it's also your obliques and your side intercostals, and it's your back muscles, And it's all those interior muscles that are like around all of your organs and connect to your diaphragm and to your rib cage, and everything is super connected. And it includes the diaphragm, which is a muscle, even though it's an involuntary muscle. And then the other thing that's so amazing about the core is that it actually goes all the way down the top outside part of your legs. So it's even attached to your limbs as well. So it's this huge, massive part that balances your entire body and connects to everything that has to do with supporting our posture, but also supporting our breath, which means also supporting our voice.
So we often hear from teachers, ground yourself. You need to be more grounded. You need to be more stable. You need to be into the ground. When you mentioned that the core extends into the outer part of the legs, that's what I thought. I was like, oh, this all makes so much sense. Yeah. But then there's also the pelvic floor is part of grounding, right? As well.
That's correct. Yeah. So the pelvic floor is like right at the base of your pelvic bone. It's often associated with Kegels. I always think about that like old lady that used to give like sex talks on TV. but she was always talking about the pelvic floor muscles and Kegels and things like that. But the pelvic floor is incredibly important to our support as singers. It's whenever someone's talking about low support, they're talking about your low frontal core, but they're also talking about the pelvic floor muscles. And that's why I know there are a lot of teachers that tell people to squeeze their butt or to think about kind of, I've heard very strange things, but thinking about squeezing your inner thighs. That's that exact same muscle that you're playing around with. That's the pelvic floor. And then to add on to that, our core is connected to something called the deep front line, which runs all the way from the very base of our feet up the front of our leg, through our knees, through our hip flexors, and then all the way up into our larynx area and beyond. So that's what grounding is. I mean, the core then connects to the deep front line, and you literally can do things with your feet and toes that will affect whether your larynx is in a stressed position or not. It's insane.
It's amazing. It's amazing how everything in the body is so interconnected.
Oh yeah. Unbelievable.
Where going back to, I guess, your background, for people who want to learn more about this, how would you suggest learning about, I mean, you're talking about all this anatomical things, physiology. Do you have any suggestions?
That's a great question. I've learned a lot about this sort of piecing it together because I started out as a dancer. I did ballet for many, many years, and I've done yoga and I've done all kinds of other things. But actually the way that I started piecing together all the anatomy was by taking anatomy for musicians classes and classes that were talking about preventative care so that we don't injure ourselves. And then I met Jay Caldwell of Singing Body Clinic. And he gives webinars on this type of stuff where he's talking about how everything's interconnected and how to feel what is good tension versus bad tension. Because his mission in life is to say, like, tension is a thing we need. Otherwise, we are a puddle on the floor that has no structure. But his webinars were really connected a lot of the dots for me. Because I always say to people, you know, a lot of times for singers, we take vocal pedagogy classes. And a lot of that really technical scientific language just goes like whoop, and you can, or it's presented really in a localized way. So, for example, I was telling people, I remember the first time I was seeing what the diaphragm looked like. It was just kind of this thing floating near the rest of the spine, and there were no other muscles involved in that drawing. And I was just like, cool. So the diaphragm just kind of floats and doesn't connect to anything. But if you know that it's part of the core and you know that it attaches to your spine and you know that it attaches to multiple parts of your spine, it changes everything. So yeah, I highly recommend checking out Jay's webinars, but also just doing a little bit of research on the anatomy of the body and seeing how everything connects.
That's great. Thank you. Yeah. So when you hear, when singers hear engage the core, what does that mean? Is there a way that we can put that into practice?
Definitely. So part of what my mission was for the Core Foundations Boot Camp was to give people ways to not only strengthen the core and understand how to engage it, but literally understand how to activate it. because a lot of those low core muscles, like the pelvic floor, are things that we don't necessarily think about engaging every single day when we're just sitting in front of our computers or even walking around. So one of my absolute favorite exercises for starting to work the entirety of the core and engaging every single part of it is actually one of the poses from yoga, which is cat-cow. So it's when you're on all fours, right? And you slowly arch your back like a really scared Halloween cat. And then you come back into a really arched back. And if you start from the very base of your spine, from your tailbone, and you think about zipping up the front of your abs and up the front of your core, you start to feel how that teeny tiny movement is actually slowly heating up every single part of your core as you go. And then you'll feel how the neck and the spine just kind of respond to that and are a part of it, because those are deep core muscles too. So that's one of my absolute favorite things. And then there are things that get more and more advanced, like doing plank and going to downward dog from plank. But cat-cow is like the best way to start out.
That's so great. So you mentioned plank, and that brings up another question. I wanted to talk about misconceptions about the core. And one of the things that you hear often, maybe less so today than I think maybe in years past, I think the viewpoint is getting a little bit more progressive on this, but when we talk about exercise and the core,
yeah,
and as a singer, what we should be doing, what could be detrimental, what could be helpful, could you elaborate on that a little bit?
Definitely. So I have to say, my husband is someone who really enjoys exercise, and I remember him talking about us exercising together, and this was 6-7 years ago. And I remember saying, well, I have to be really careful about what I do as a singer because I didn't want to lock anything up, which, like you said, is really kind of a misconception. I think the more core work that we as singers can do, the better, because it's going to give us strengthening in our entire coordination of our breath muscles. And it strengthens those muscles that control the diaphragm. The thing that's important though, is to combine that with making sure that you are stretching and working on flexibility, because if you go into a hardcore core workout and you don't stretch afterwards, then those muscles do kind of tighten and bunch together. And it's harder to find that active suspension that we're always looking for as singers. So I think there's nothing wrong with doing very intensive workouts, as long as you're varying between days and you're making sure that you're doing a really good stretching routine as well as whatever the muscle building is.
Yes. Cross training is one of my passions, not necessarily physically. I could definitely do more workout cross training, but in terms of cross training our bodies and our instruments and singing and stretching the muscles in different ways, engaging the muscles in different ways, I think it's so important.
Yeah. And I think that it then informs our singing too, because we are able to change the way that we inhale and change the way that we exhale, which is a way to play with dynamics and a way to play with phrasing and things like that. So it also gives us flexibility within our artistry if we're giving our body different challenges and different relaxation depending on the day and workout.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. So I know, thinking back to my high school years, my undergrad years, most of my grad years, my teachers would say support. They would say engage your core. Yep. They would say you need your abajo, your butt support, all those terms, all those words. And I thought I was doing it, but I wasn't. And I find that that's the way with most singers and most students, is we think we're doing it. We're trying really hard. So I guess the question is, what's going on there? Where's the disconnect between thinking you're doing it and understanding what actually needs to happen for our breath support to engage the core in a way that is going to, use our air most efficiently?
Yeah. I mean, I think again, it kind of comes down to that floating head singer idea, that sort of syndrome, because we as like good students want to go and research all of this stuff. And so we look at the anatomy, we learn the scientific terms. And so intellectually we know, okay, I need to breathe in a way that my diaphragm is going to descend and stay descended for as long as possible. Intellectually, I know that my rib cage needs to expand. Intellectually, I know I need to use my pelvic floor. But if you haven't even located or activated those muscles, how do you know that you're using them? And so that's why I've become such a big proponent with my current teacher, who I met about 5 years ago, in my practice, combining physical movement with the way that I breathe and with actual singing, so that I can hear and feel the difference as I'm performing singing. So I remember the first lesson I had with him, I walked in the door and he listened to me for a little bit and he said, okay, I know exactly what's going on. You're not engaging your low core. And I was like, okay. I mean, like, I think I can try to engage my low core more. And he was like, no, like, I have a tool for that. And so the reason I'm rustling over here is because then he pulled out this Pilates circle, which is a collapsible thing. And he said, put it between your inner thighs. And when you breathe in, you're going to let your knees open. So the Pilates circle will open. And as soon as you start your exhale and you start your phrase, you're going to squeeze your knees together until and past the end of the phrase. And I was like, okay, this is really hard, because I was having trouble coordinating it, because it's coordinating both large and small muscles that we don't use every single day. And I've done Pilates in the past and I do that kind of work. And I walked out of that room after 30 minutes of using the Pilates circle going, I can't feel my inner thighs anymore. But the other thing that I had realized was that I had never used those muscles in my singing before, ever. And I also immediately heard a difference in the sound and realized that I was making a fuller sound without feeling tension in those compensatory muscles in my neck. So the more that you can give yourself actual tools to practice engaging and activating those muscles while you sing, the more you'll be able to realize what's going on when things aren't working.
That's great. So I'm thinking of a lot of my students, and a common question that comes up is, do I need to think I'm pushing out? Do I need to think I'm coming in? Do I need to think I'm scooping? Do I need to think down? Right? There's all these different directions. And when we think about the core, the voice, the lungs and the rib cage, we think of all the components of our body, you know, we're multidimensional, we're 360. And the core, right? There's all these different layers, as you mentioned. So every person's different, right? So every person might need to translate that in a way that is custom to that person's needs. But what thoughts do you have on that language and on, I guess, directional thinking?
Yeah. Well, and I love that you point out that everyone is a unique body and an individual body, because I don't think that there's necessarily one instruction you can give to every singer that's going to fix them. I think in the long run, there's a coordination that works best for most people, but the approach is going to be different. So it's really important that you start exploring your own body. Like when you're working out, when you're traveling, when you're at your most stressed out, start doing some body mapping just to notice where you carry tension in your body. And that's going to affect the way that you do warm-ups. So for example, I know that I hold a lot of tension in my super low back, which is actually affected by the hip flexors, because I sit a lot. So the front of my hips get really, really tight, which gives me a little bit of like an arched back. So when I'm traveling and I'm super stressed out, I know the first thing I have to do before I practice, before I try auditioning, is to engage my front low core to release my lower back. Because otherwise I can't breathe into my back. So if I'm thinking about that 360 degree core and I haven't done something to warm up my front lower core and release my lower back, there's no way that I'm making use of that 360 degree core. All of this to say, get to know your body, get to know which parts of that 360 degree core you haven't yet explored, because maybe you've totally mastered the appoggio. You're like, man, I'm so awesome at pushing out in front and doing that lean on the front diaphragm. But maybe you have worked so hard on that front part that you've forgotten that you can expand into the back. And that's going to give you this amazing, like I said, active suspension where there's opposition. And it's almost like a sphere all the way around, and you're missing part of that sphere. I mean, there are times in our development where we have to focus on one part of that 360 degree, and then we have to balance it back out. So knowing your body and knowing where you are in your development is going to be your unique journey.
That is such great advice. I'm wondering from the perspective of a teacher, because I know we have a lot of teachers in this group as well, what thoughts do you have for helping a teacher identify which component their student needs to work on?
That's an awesome question. I love that. What I like to do is kind of, I'll have my singers sing for me a little bit and I kind of watch what's going on in their body. And I notice that for almost every single singer that comes to me, and it still is something that I do as well, what happens is you see that, especially on lines where you're going down, you're descending, the rib cage likes to sink towards the hip bones, right? Yep. So one of the things that I like to go to first is checking in with what's going on between that lowest rib on your side and your hip bone. And so I'll have my students just kind of like massage that area and notice if their ribs really want to go down or if their hips really want to come up or if they're feeling their oblique muscle in the front just kind of kicking against their hands and seeing if they can keep that soft. So that's one way to start, because what it does is it also allows them to notice, are they gripping in the front? Are they expanding into the back? Because if you're massaging, you can feel if you're breathing into your thumbs in the back or not. And it's also going to tell you if those ribs are sinking down really hard, it's going to tell you those ribs probably aren't expanding out or back to front either. So it's a really good place to start, but you can also notice if a singer is kind of collapsing in on themselves, and that means maybe you want to work on the appoggio first, or you might notice that your singer has a really sway back and likes to stick their tush out, which is moi. And so maybe you want to play around with thinking of like a pelvic tuck and really breathing into a cushion against a wall so they can start to realize that they have expansion in their back.
Yes. And I want to point out something that you said, and that is the sensory elements of singing. So as singers, we feel our voices, right? We feel our voices internally because we can't hear them the way that the audience hears.
Exactly.
Hears ourselves sing. So, but as a singing student, as a student of singing, or as a teacher of singing, we can rely on the other senses as well. And one of the biggest ones is sight. Mm-hmm. And I think that a lot of times people underestimate how much sight factors into our technique and our ability to practice and to grow as singers. And so I guess I just want to mention that because a lot of people are going to be teaching online or taking lessons online. And as singers, we often hear practice in the mirror. And that's one of the reasons why. But also as teachers, you know, I think a lot of people are discouraged about the sound delays and the sound quality over online teaching. But there's so much that you can assess and analyze and work with without even hearing a sound.
Oh my God, yeah. And one of the biggest things, I remember one of the biggest things that was a revelation for me and has been a revelation for so many students is the posture of your neck. Because so many of us are sitting at our computers like this, or we're texting, or we're driving like a grandma. And as soon as you can just think about your chin tucking a little bit and getting the back of your neck nice and long, oh my God, you're right on top of this incredibly efficient tube of air. And the sound quality difference is just insanely huge, but it is something that we've trained ourselves to just sit like this all the time. And so the more that you have a visual confirmation of what's going on, the more you can kind of check in on it and keep going, okay, all right, fine. Like I keep pulling forward, so let me just readjust. And so actually having the screen for Zoom lessons is an incredible tool because it's like singing into a mirror and you have your voice teacher there checking in with you.
Yes, absolutely. So in terms of the breathing tube and the core, could we just talk for a second about that relationship and how they interact together?
Sure. Yeah. So like I said, our core, because it's this 360 degree sort of trunk of the body, right? It's our main stabilizers. It's the muscles that allow us to have good posture or bad posture, whether that's sort of slumped over or overarched in the back. And what I like to tell my students is think about a garden hose, right? if you have a kink in your garden hose, the water is not going to flow smoothly whatsoever, especially if it's kinked in a couple different places. So if your lower back is arched and you're sticking your chin out, your garden hose has two kinks in it. And it's the same thing if you're kind of slumped over. It's a different kind of kink, but it's still causing a blockage in the efficiency of your flow. So as you train all 360 degrees, you're balancing your spine and supporting your spine to be in its most natural position, right? The position that it was supposed to be in, that allows your airway to be the most efficient pathway possible. And as you train those 360 degree core muscles, you also are allowing your rib cage to stay expanded and your diaphragm to be descended. And so you can control and play with the air speed through that tube as well.
Yes, that's a great image. I love that visual of the garden hose.
Yeah.
I always think
I ask some of my younger students and I'm like, have you used a garden hose?
I haven't. The one I always use is the toothpaste tube.
Yes, that's a great one too.
But yeah. The same concept. Yeah. So moving on to another type of core. How does the physical core impact the core of the sound?
Yeah, I love this so much because I resisted for so long getting into good physical shape for singing that when I did really start using my physical core, it was a complete surprise to me how much I was able to access who I was in myself, right? So there's a couple of different things, right? First of all, you're finding your natural posture, which makes you feel powerful and strong because you're standing in the way that you're meant to be standing and you're not worried about taking up space, because if you're standing with your full posture, you're not worrying about it. It's not a concern anymore. So first of all, you've already decided to take up space, which is a confidence booster, right? On top of that, your core being strong means that your whole body feels strong because you're supporting yourself. You have incredible access to the efficiency of your breath, things like that. But the other thing is that breathing is so intrinsically linked to your nervous system, which means that it's intrinsically linked to your mood. And it kind of allows you to access different states, whether that's going to be a really meditative calming state, or if you're somebody who actually gets a little bit too low energy before something where you need to pump up, you can speed up your breathing to energize yourself. It's part of the reason that we yawn, right? We're trying to get a little bit more access to energy through our breathing. And so through exploring those different types of breath, through that really efficient tube and through that really strong core, the volume and fullness of your voice that comes out is almost overwhelming. It's something you didn't realize that you had inside yourself. And it's the same as that confidence that you feel as you start to take up space. And from there, you can start to explore like more vulnerable places. And it's a little hard to even explain. But as you get more and more strong in your core and you get more and more connected to the different ways that you can breathe, you find different niches of your voice, which allow you, like I said, to paint with very different brushes and paint with very different palettes of colors, which is what we all strive for as artists. We want to have something to say, but then we have to figure out, okay, how do I say it that way?
Yes. And I love that you said different palettes of colors and different brush strokes, because I think sometimes there's a misconception when we talk about the core of the sounds. Sometimes people think that that needs to be loud.
Right.
Or that being soft means not having a core.
Correct. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, one of the things I love about the way my teacher frames it is that they always talk about having, it relates more to chest voice, but they always talk about having a thread of your chest voice throughout your entire range. And to me, it's more remembering that there's core throughout the entire sound. So even in our softest pianissimi floated notes, your core is still there. Because if it wasn't, it not only detaches you from your source of strength and your source of power, but the people around you feel it. All of a sudden they're like, wait, where'd you go? I lost you. And then you're just fighting to get it back the whole time, whether it's in a rehearsal, in a practice session, or in a performance.
Absolutely. And I think it's important to note that the core of the sound, if you're singing with core of the sound, it doesn't matter if you're singing loud, soft, in head voice, in chest voice, if you're singing musical theater, if you're singing opera, that core essence, that core sound is still there. And it really is, it's a connection to the physical core, a connection with your breath, the way that your vocal cords are phonating together.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I think there's a couple things I wanna say about volume. Sometimes we think being the loudest person in the room is the strongest person in the room, but I think the opposite is true. I remember when I was studying, I actually went and got a degree in education, and I was talking to a bunch of my friends who were going through similar training or who were doing other teaching programs. And we all kind of came to the same conclusion at the same time. Like, we all had had a really bad day in the classroom and had tried shouting and it was not working. It was just kind of escalating the situation. And some of us decided to go and kind of retreat into ourselves and just kind of sit down and say something really softly, whether that was like, I'm done now, or I'll wait until you're done, or we can just resume tomorrow. And just that quietness was really powerful and kind of, it acted as a vacuum where the attention of the entire room was like, shoo, back to you. And it makes me think, and I'm pretty sure this is a Kallas quote, but I'll have to double check it. She said something about how being still and soft is the most difficult and most powerful thing that you as an artist can do. And if you think about it, like, so many young singers and even those of us who are a little nervous about something, the first thing we do is start fidgeting and moving around and thinking, oh, maybe they can't hear me, and like pushing, right? So I think there's so much truth to that. And finding stillness is finding your core and finding your balance and finding your center. And singing softly is finding the most strong, powerful part of your core and keeping the breath going actually even faster than you need it for loud. So yeah, soft is a whole nother world of power. It's very interesting.
Yes. One of my favorite pieces of advice regarding dynamics is that dynamics are not a volume, they are a quality. They're an emotional quality.
Yeah.
And to go along with that, then, you know, you hear to sing softly actually requires more support. It's more intense than singing loud.
So much, yeah.
And I would actually say in some ways it's more active as well.
Oh yeah. Because the second that you think, okay, I found the sweet spot, and you take a backseat to it, it's gone.
Absolutely. Yeah,
totally.
So when we talk about finding your core for your sound and your core in your body, what about the core of you as an artist and what you bring to the table beyond just a beautiful voice? Where, yeah, how do we discuss the core in those terms?
Yeah, I think they're all interrelated, right? So if you're playing around with strengthening your core and strengthening your understanding of yourself through breathing, through experimenting with this strength and flexibility work. It was funny, I had posted a question probably a month ago on Instagram, just asking people like, hey, do you guys ever experience unexpected emotions when you're doing yoga or something like that? Because there are times when I'm in some kind of stretch, and often it involves my glute muscles and my hip flexors where I hold a lot of my tension. And I'm just kind of stretching and I'm like breathing and trying to relax into that stretch and, you know, breathe into it so it's a little bit deeper. And all of a sudden I just start crying. And it's like, where did that come from? Or you're in the middle of a side stretch or whatever it is, and you just start giggling hysterically for no reason. And so I think it's part of that self-exploration. It's like, okay, I've had this unexpected emotional response as I was breathing and as I was stretching into this muscle. Maybe I should sit down and think about where that was coming from and what that emotion did to me physically and how I might be able to recreate that if it were in a character or something like that. So the more we explore our emotions through our physical body, through our breath, again, the palette of colors expands. And we start to get to know ourselves and our emotional tendencies and reactions as well, so that we can start deciding and understanding what our story is and how it affects the way that we tell the stories of the characters that we embody, whether that's an operatic character, an art song narrator or character, or a musical theater, or whatever it is. So it gives us a closer look into our unique experience and how that can be expressed through other people's words and notes.
Yes. And I love what you said about how you would put yourself in a physical pose and then you would feel an emotion. Mm-hmm. And so often we think it's the other way around. We think,
oh, yeah,
I feel nervous and therefore my body closes. But it's actually the opposite, right? Because in the word emotion is motion. So right. It's that our body becomes tense and then we have the thought and the feeling.
Right.
And in terms of being actors on stage and embodying a character, the way that we can recreate that is to give ourselves physical tools, a physical vocabulary and technique for that character.
Exactly.
Versus trying to recreate the emotion within ourselves.
Because yeah. And what's really interesting about this too, is that the more we experiment with that, the more we can play with oppositions and dichotomies. Like we were talking about that a little bit with the strengthening of the core, but it's also important as you're embodying different types of characters while still trying to keep your strength underneath you. Like I remember last summer, and I can't remember if you and I have talked about this, I was singing Blanche in Dialogue of the Carmelites, right? And she, her entire life is based around fear. Her entire character, all of her motivations, she is petrified of death. And there's a lot of reason for that. But the question for the singer of that character is, how do I show fear while still keeping all the strength and power that I need to physically and vocally get through this role? And oh boy, is that an adventure. But it all comes down to playing with the things that you can do with your body that are working together in tandem or working in adversity, and figuring that out. So the more that you experiment with the physicality and the vocalization in those physicalizations, the more that you can play with and the more that you can show and feel at the same time.
Yes, absolutely. Because in truth, you know, we don't need to feel it. The audience needs to feel it.
Right. And sometimes if we feel it, the audience loses it.
Yes, absolutely. And also, you know, there's a lot of opera singers in this group, and operas tend to play in very large houses. So if somebody's sitting in the back balcony at the Met, right, they're not going to probably see that little tear down your cheek, right?
Yeah.
So the physical is so important in the storytelling and getting to the root and the core of who the character is, for sure.
Yeah, and it's so funny. I remember for a really long time, and still kind of to this day, I used to really struggle with the idea of how to embody a character on a stage that is in a larger house versus how to embody a character in a small audition room where the people might be sitting like 5 feet away from you. Because if you do it the same way, say you take the larger stage version to the audition room, they're like, wow, this person's really overdramatic and ridiculous. But then if you took the audition version to the stage, people would be like, oh my God, she's so boring. She doesn't know how to act, blah, blah, blah. And so it's this really difficult situation that we singers have to put ourselves into. Like, how do I understand the largesse of gesture on stage and then shrink it down so that it's still effective from 5 feet away? It's a real challenge that very few people talk about in our field. And yeah. I don't understand it. I'm like, why don't we have classes that talk about drama for auditions versus drama for the stage?
It's so important. And for actors, you know, stage acting versus film acting, it's the same.
Exactly. Yeah. All these close-ups. And that's why these like live in HD things are so tricky for the singers, because it's like, well, I have to make a decision. Do I play to the house and look a little bit ridiculous on HD or vice versa? And then like the 5,000 people that are in the house are going to be disappointed.
But I think ultimately it gets back to the core.
Yeah.
And
if you have to decide what is doing justice to the character for you.
Yes. And that core, that center, right? That core thread, whether you're playing at your largest, you know, up to the fifth balcony, or mm-hmm. you're playing in a little living room, the core of you, yeah. the core of that character is still there.
Yeah, totally.
So I want to talk a little bit about core in terms of artistry and humanity and self-awareness and values, aside from the singing part, but in terms of how we decide who we are as people and artists, how we decide what types of roles and repertoire and styles of music we want to take on, in terms yeah. of the impact we can make on the world. It's a very, very broad, open-ended question, but I'd love to hear some of your thoughts.
I think it's so important, though, because especially as we train in undergraduate and as we train even as graduate students and young artists and things like that, we're given guidelines and we're given guidance, right? Like for your juries, you have to present things in these languages. And for your auditions, like we're going to label you as a light lyric soprano so you can sing these arias or nothing else. And that's helpful when you're first starting out, but then you get kind of stuck and you think, okay, I have my path like carved out before me and I don't necessarily like singing Ach ich fühl's like 50 bazillion times, but that's what they told me to do. Yeah. And then you start getting feedback like, I don't know if you're really a Pamina because our voices change and mature. All this to say that as you're going through your education, I think that those guidelines are helpful starting paths, but then you as the singer get to start playing a little bit. And I think this time in quarantine and with the pandemic, honestly, is kind of a gift because we have the time to play a little bit. Like you can still record your audition arias that you know that you've set out with your teacher, but you can start playing around with some new repertoire. And on top of that, you can start doing what I really encourage people to do is to do some background research on these operas and these characters that we all know super well, but maybe don't understand the historical context in which they were written. And we maybe don't understand the effect that they had on the audiences at the time. And maybe we haven't explored the composers that were around at that time that are lesser known. And maybe we'd fall in love with them and maybe we'd really identify or not identify with the purpose of the work that was being written. So you can learn a lot from looking at the context. And I think that that's an important thing for us to do as artists in the modern world too, like look around at what's going on in our world, because in times of strife, that's when the best art can be made because it tells our story.
Yes.
Oh. So just be, you know, be aware and be involved in conversations and feel your feelings, you know, like write in a journal or talk to your friends or have a happy hour or go for a walk, whatever it is that lets you just kind of think and meditate and feel and not try to bottle things up. You know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely. I love what you said about context.
Yeah.
And a few things came to mind that I just want to speak on. And that is that the first is context in terms of understanding the world around you and understanding the work. And the more that we research, the more that we know, the more that we can empathize.
Oh my God, yes. Empathy. If we don't have empathy as artists, no art is being made, in my opinion. If you can't empathize with your character, then you can't play that role with 100% justice given to that character. And it may be someone that you hate. like, oh my God, this person is such a jackass. You know, like imagine playing the Count. He's not a good dude, right? And so you could come into it saying, wow, I really hate this guy. He's a womanizer. He's not very good to his friends. But you have to find a way to walk in his shoes and see his reasoning and see his justification of it, and then really truly feel whether or not he feels repentant at the end, or if he's just like, oh, well, I got caught this one time, but he's scheming. And so you know what I mean? Like, you have to put yourself in those shoes. And by doing that with someone that you really don't identify with, you can learn so much about other people in the world.
Yes. And I think you can learn so much about yourself too.
Yeah,
I actually took this amazing class with Billy Bustamante through Jen Waldman's studio online. And mm-hmm. it was a musical theater class all about picking a character who was the complete opposite of you.
I love it.
And he walked us through exercises where we literally wrote down different character traits, from physical traits to mental traits, different skills of the character and of ourselves. And we could see where they
interacted.
Yeah,
that's so cool. I love that.
Yeah. And so you really can learn so much about yourself, about your own values, about your own strengths and skills, but then also seeing things through another's eyes, which is what art is really all about, I think.
Totally. I mean, I remember looking at Blanche and saying like, oh my God, she's just so afraid of everything. Like, get it together, girl. You know what I mean? But the more you explore it, the more you think like, well, we're all afraid of dying. And this girl lost her mother before she was even a person. I mean, her mother died in this like horrific accident, gave birth to her, and then died. But anyway, yeah, it's a point of understanding new parts of yourself and really identifying new parts of yourself and seeing new perspectives that you probably haven't considered. Like, there's so much fighting and debating right now, and we really polarize ourselves to say, well, that person did this thing and I can't identify with that, so I'm not even going to engage with them. But what's productive about that? You can't have a conversation that's going to lead anywhere with that person. And we don't change and evolve by acting that way.
Absolutely. And if we think of ourselves as having a core, a center, I think also humanity as a whole, there's a core, a common core,
yeah,
that threads through all of us and connects all of us. Which is pretty inspiring to me, I think, and very cool. So I'm going back and I'm thinking about the conversation we had about dynamics. And mm-hmm. I am remembering something that my undergraduate teacher, Sunny Joy Langton, told me. And she said that when she was performing professionally, she remembers standing next to different singers. And some of those singers were so loud and they couldn't be heard in the hall.
Yeah.
And some of those singers were so soft that she worried about them being heard in the hall, and yet their voices just rang. And I think obviously there's a lesson in that in terms of your sounds and what carries and finding the singer's format and all of that. But I think there's also a lesson about staying in your own lane and finding being true to yourself and having that self-awareness.
Yeah.
Versus falling victim to comparison and feeling.
Yeah. I mean, comparison's a big thing. But I think the other thing that's really important within that is something my teacher really, really pushes on people. By the way, this is Mark Schneibly and Trish McCaffrey. They are always reminding us as students not to listen to our own sound, because our bodies change every single day. That's the fun part of being a person whose instrument is your body. It's going to be different every single day. So if you're listening for a specific sound, you're going to be trying to manufacture by creating bad tension in new places, instead of trusting the strength and flexibility and coordination that you've trained in your body, and knowing what good posture is and knowing what the flexibility needs to be, instead of listening for a specific sound. Because again, like, oh, I sound really soft. I bet people can't hear me. But sometimes if you can't hear yourself well, it means that you've got this like surround sound speaker going on and everyone else in the room is like, wow, that's amazing. And it goes to the fifth balcony in the Met or whatever it is.
Yeah. And that makes me wonder, you know, we're talking about the core of ourselves as artists too. And so I'm wondering what tactical tools people can take away if they're having trouble hearing themselves or if they're trying to listen to themselves, not necessarily in a singer way, but just trying to develop self-awareness and feeling like wanting, you know, I guess wanting some more clarity, wanting some more answers, and like, how do we develop that self-awareness? So I'm wondering, yeah, if you have any suggestions.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it comes down to experimenting again, playing around with things, but also using these incredible technology tools that we have, recording yourself, listening back to it, recording yourself in different spaces, but then also having colleagues whose ears you trust, who get to know your voice really, really well. But I think, you know, when it comes down to not listening, not overly listening to your sound that you produce, what we're doing when we're over-listening is over-analyzing, right? And so when you're trying to express yourself in a certain way and you're listening and going, ah, is that really how I want to do that? Is that really the piano I want to create? It's the same thing. You're analyzing and you're getting stuck in your head again instead of just letting that sound be as a moment in time and then going back and saying like, oh, maybe in the next performance, I want to slightly change the way that I do that. But we have to live in the moment and even in the future instead of reversing and rewinding all the time and going, oh, I don't know how I felt about that. Like, don't be your own self-critic the whole time. And I know that I do this all the time. So it's way easier said than done.
I do too. I mean, we all do. But yeah, just thinking about finding the core, and I think also expressing our values, like that is such an important part of the core. And when we are overanalyzing like that, we're really not acting on our values. That's actually not as active as just letting it be, acting first.
And right. Yeah, in a lot of ways, that's kind of a passive way to be experiencing your own self-expression. And why would you want to be passive in that?
Okay, so I just have a couple more questions for you. Actually, the first question before we get to the final two, and speaking of the core, I'm wondering if you could just quickly walk us through a typical day for you and some activities that you might engage in to access different parts of your core.
Sure. And in fact, I can even share, I made like a little, what do they call it? Like a time lapse of a warm up that I was doing the other day. And it was especially funny because my puppy was just, as soon as I get on the floor, my puppy's like, it's playtime. So I'm in the middle of doing some like crunches and she's literally sitting on my stomach. So I'll see if I can share that. but yeah, so if I know that I'm singing at a certain time for coaching or if I'm teaching or if I have my own lesson, there is a very specific warm up that I do that takes about 5 minutes. And it works even if I've been sitting in front of my computer being a horrible posture person all morning. and so what I typically do is I use my little gorgeous ball, which is like a squishy exercise ball, and you don't fill it 100%. And what I do is I lie on that between my floater rib and my hip bone, and I breathe, and then I actually put some resistance against it. And as I exhale, I release all that resistance so the ball can really get into those muscle tissues. So I do that on both sides. I do it on my front right beneath my sternum so that it can release some of that tension that we hold right in the solar plexus. I know that when we're sitting and like just slumped over, we hold a lot of tension there. And then I'll usually do some stretches for the back of my neck. So I put that same ball between my shoulder blades when I'm lying on the floor and I just lean and breathe. And as I exhale, I always put a little bit more resistance into my hands from my head. And then from there, I'll do a couple of ab warm-ups. So I do what are called rope climbers, where I'm lying on my back with my legs up in the air and I'm reaching for the opposite foot. And I do some of those. Then I do some stretches for the front muscles of my neck because I do know I tend to do this. So I stretch those out. And then I'll actually do some push-ups against the wall. So I don't have to make my life hard. I don't have to do it on the floor. but it's enough to activate my core a little bit and open my chest and bring my shoulder blades towards one another, which counteracts some of that slouching that we tend to do. And that's it. And by then, my voice actually feels pretty warmed up. I don't have to do much vocalizing, but I can if I would like to, and if I want to make sure that I can stretch into the extremities of my range. But it's super quick, it's super relaxing, and it just resets all of my tense tendencies that I have when I'm sitting in the mornings and things like that.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
I love silent warm-ups.
Yeah. I mean, all you have to do is warm up your body, and your body is your voice, right? And then you're just ready to go.
Yes. Snaps to that.
Yes.
Okay. So I have two last questions.
Mm-hmm.
And these questions I ask all of our guests. So they are based on the titles of two Victorian parlor games.
I love it.
And the first question is lighting the candle. Is there a person, an organization, a resource that you would like to illuminate?
Yes. I mean, there are so many. It was funny because I was thinking about this. You had like sent me a little warning that this was coming. So I was going through this huge list of people because there are such incredible artists in our circle that you should all look into. But one of the companies that has popped up partially because of quarantine, because there was finally time for this project, is a company called the Podcast Opera Company. And the idea is that each season is going to have one theme, and this inaugural season, their theme is community. So they're talking about community and how they interact when people fall really ill, communal living, things like that. And so they've created these episodic operas that are being written and composed as they go forward in the season. So I was asked to be involved in one called Friend's House. That's about a Quaker communal house. And the people who live in that house have decided to create a podcast to find a new roommate. And so it goes back and forth between podcast dialogue and then sung, performed music, some of which is set in the Quaker house as part of a meeting. And it's composed by Stephen Crino and written by Joshua Scheid. And it's just been an incredible experience, and I love what they're doing. It made me think about so many things. First of all, making opera feel like it's relevant right now in a format that a lot of us listen to, like podcasts. And I've had conversations with people about making episodic Netflix type series for operas. And so I was just so excited when Henry Hubbard told me about this idea, because it also reminded me of those like old radio dramas with all their sound effects and stuff like that. And I was just like, this is brilliant. So they've put out their first couple episodes. There's a three-part series called Mallory about someone who's suffering from cancer that just came out. And then in September will be Friend's House. And so you can subscribe to them on Apple Podcasts, and they have a Facebook page and a website. So go check out the Podcast Opera Company because they're doing amazing things.
That's very cool. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
My last question is called the parrot. And if we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
Oh boy. Oh gosh, that's so hard. I think I would say breathe in and trust yourself.
Breathe in and trust yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you, Claire Galloway. Where can everybody find you?
So you can find me on Facebook, Claire Galloway Soprano, or on Instagram, same thing. And that's my website as well, Claire Galloway Soprano, all over the place.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your incredible expertise, for sharing your beautiful spirit and all of those tips and techniques with us. We're so grateful. Thank you to everybody who is watching. And if you have any ideas for anybody who might be a great guest in the Self-Care for Singers Group Practice Parlor episodes, please let me know. Please share this. Please invite your friends to the group, and we will see you soon. Thanks,
everyone. Thank you so much, Gina. This was amazing. Thank you.
Have a great day.
Bye.